worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was suppressed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is my third homegrown pineapple, Anasi, as I call it here. They do not become that big up here in the cold, but nevertheless, they still are very aromatic and small. I'm kind of proud of that, coming from Denmark, where it's impossible to grow pineapple. Homegrown pineapple, friends? That's something, I think. And that's the scaffolding wall for the last middle wall of the meditation hall that will be here, and that when the rainy, misty December weather stops, then we'll make this cement wall. One problem is that we have no sand, we have only the iron has come up so far. So we need the sand, 50 bags of sand, no, 100 bags of sand and 20 bags of cement carried up before this. The guys are carrying up, but they are hurting in their back and shoulders from the job. So we are taking a break. Thank you for your attention, consideration, and support. Heidi ho!
Hello to you, friends. This is What Buddha Said, number 7, with readings from the Tipitaka, in this case the Anguttara Nikaya, the numerical sayings of the Buddha. And we are in the Book of Ones, and this is the 6th sutta, and it's called the Finger Snap Achara Sangata, or Radiant as a by title. But first, as usual, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. And the speech, the sutta, sutta means something that streams into the mind, information, goes like this. The Buddha said, radiant is this mind, bhikkhus, yet it is soiled by alien defilements. This does the ordinary, unlearned person not understand as it really is. I tell you, that is why such uneducated, ordinary person neither meditate nor develop mentally. Luminous is that mind, because when it is released from these foreign impurities, this does the learned noble disciple understand as it really is. I tell you, that is why that educated noble disciples develops mentally by meditation. Because if a monk practices universal friendliness, metta, even during only the period of a fingersnap, then such monk may be called a bhikkhu who is not without focus and who is living in accordance with the teaching, with the Dhamma. One who neither opposes the master's advice nor eats the alm food of the people without a purpose, without an aim. What then should be said about those who train it much? This universal friendliness. Because if a monk develops universal friendliness during even only the instant of a fingersnap, then such monk may be described as a bhikkhu who is not without concentration, who is living in agreement with the teaching, one who neither resists the master's advice nor eats armed food of the citizens without justification. What then should be said about those who train it much? Bhikkhus, if a monk directs his attention towards universal friendliness, even during only the duration of a fingersnap, then such monk may be designated a monk who is not without absorption, who is not without concentration, and who is living in harmony with the teaching, with the Dhamma. One who acts upon the master's instruction and eats armed food of the country with an aim. What then should be said about those who train this universal friendliness much? Whatsoever there are detrimental states, because connected with the wrong, joined with the evil, all these are initiated by the mind. First does the preceding bad mental state arise, then these disadvantageous phenomena, situations and events follow after. Whatsoever there are of advantageous states, bhikkhus, it is connected with right, related with the good, all these are also initiated by the mind. First does this preceding clever mental state arrive, and then these advantageous phenomena, situations and events follow after. Bhikkhus, I know of no other single thing as neglect, which both makes non-arising detrimental states emerge and also eliminates any present advantageous mental states. Bhikkhus, if wrong is not yet present, then negligence make it begin, and also makes what is good waste and fade away. Bhikkhus, I comprehend no other single thing, as being alert, acutely alert, which makes both non-arising advantageous states emerge, and which also eliminates any present detrimental states. Because if good is not yet present, alertness makes it begin, and also make what is wrong, what is evil, fade away. Because I perceive no other single phenomena as laziness, which either makes unarising evil states appear, or eliminates whatever is a useful, advantageous state. Because if bad is not yet present, then laziness makes it begin, and it also makes all that is valuable vanish. And this is from whatbuddhasaid.net under Canon, under Suttas, under Anguttara Nikaya 1, Book of Ones, page 1 to 10 in Nepali. There are some comments on this fingersnap sutta, and it goes like this. Practice of universal friendliness means trains the four infinite and divine states by meditation as follows. In this, it's a classic speech about from the Buddha of Metta. In this, friends, a noble friend with a mind full of friendly loving kindness pervade first one direction, then the second, then the third, then the fourth, and above, so below. All around, everywhere, boundless, infinite, and endless. Such noble friend suffuses and saturates the entire universe with a mind full of kind friendliness and with an all-embracing, exalted and expanded mind. Does such friendliness cultivated, subtle and refined, freed from any hate and any ill will? Thereafter, you can say, this is specific about metta, but the same thing goes with wishing in all four directions, infinitely expanded, waste, subtle and refined, regarding compassion, pity, mutual joy, rejoicing joy, and imperturbable equanimity. Without a purpose means for the attainment of enlightenment. So you can be in the robe because you want to attain enlightenment. There can also be other purposes. Just to attain a mode of living, if you're lazy, then you can get food and people will praise you. It can also be if you want to have an academic education. It can also be that you want to be rich and famous and so on. And these are all wrong purposes, because the noble life is to be lived with the purpose of attaining the end of suffering. And everybody else that lives in the robe for other purposes, they have the wrong aim, the wrong purpose, and therefore should not eat the arum fruits of the country. It is said that a corrupted monk, by not being celibate, simulated and faking, by not actually living the noble life, better should eat a red glowing arum bowl than even one bite of arum fruit given by the faithful devotees of the country. It is because his later self-imposed torture in hell is caused by his stealing the merit of the virtuous devotees and the possibility for support of real bhikkhus living the pure and noble life. This noble life is therefore like a razor. If rightly handled, one can cut through the deathlessness of enlightenment, but if wrongly handled, one can cut oneself into inexpressible, long-lasting pain. Buddha once noted that the failing and falling from the holy life in another tradition was like falling down from a mule. You can raise up and brush off the dust. But falling from this utterly perfect, noble life is like falling down from an elephant. One might break a leg, or one might break the neck. The two mental states, akusala dhamma, means a mental state that are painful or regretted either here and now, later or much later, either by oneself or other beings. It means a conscious, deliberate attention and associated mental properties which are rooted in or tainted by, mixed with, either greed, lobha, or hate, dosa, or ignorance, moha. All such detrimental mental states are unfavorable because they cause a painful karmic result. They condition a future conscious moment of pain, suffering, frustration. So later on, they become the seeds, the eggs, for an unhappy rebirth in a destination such as in an animal womb, the ghost realm, or existence as an angry demon, or even in hell. Advantageous states, kusala dhamma, means a mental state that is pleasurable and rejoiced in both here and now, later and much later, both by oneself and by other beings. It means a conscious, deliberate attention associated with mental properties which are rooted in and mixed with either non-greed, alobha, non-hate, adosa, and non-ignorance, amoha. This means basically non-greed is generosity, the ability to give. Non-hate is friendliness and loving-kindness. And non-moha, non-ignorance, is understanding, wisdom, comprehension. All such mental states rooted in good and clever intention causes favorable karmic results. By containing the seeds, probabilistic seeds, of a happy rebirth in destinations such as a human at the many various levels of divine deva existence. Supermundane advantageous states not related to this world do not lead to any rebirth, but to the 4 degrees of nobility, namely stream entry, once return, non-return, or arahatship. Neglect, pamada, means non-awareness, absence of mindfulness, blindness, ability to ignore, to disregard, to forget, to not noticing, to not paying attention to overlook, to omit. Negligence thereby inevitably lead to carelessness, haste, foolishness, complacency, slackness, thoughtlessness, laxity, distraction, lack of judgment, absence of prudence and caution. It comes in 2 variants, inborn and active. The inborn negligence is caused by inherent mental blindness. So it's a blindness that sits deeper in than the eyes. The eyes can see, but the mind is blind, cannot understand. So, non-intelligence and unclear short-range mentality is caused by this inborn yet reversible root of confusion, of moha. So though one comes into birth, born with this mental defilements of ignorance, of the mind being blind, this is not irreversible. One can't break it by training. One can't break it. In particular, by insight meditation, vipassana meditation, vipassana, bhavana. So it is not a mistake that is not to be repaired, but one has to work on it. There's no free lunch there either. So there's another kind of mental blindness of this neglect pamada, and then is comically caused by thinking and acting in prior lives as if other intelligent beings were futile. So one have been, probably because of envy, jealousy, can be many causes, pride, arrogance, then one has pointed out other intelligent beings, other learned beings, and said to oneself or others, they are futile, they are stupid. And this is the exact cause in the karmic mirror that is reflected back to oneself and causes one's own future blindness, ignorance, neglect, lack of intelligence, stupidity, foolishness. So this active negligence is caused by often quite deep and self-deception that one already knows better. So there's no need to listen to others or to learn, because oneself, what one thinks is oneself, and this overblown pride, this self, this ego knows better, then there's no need for this ego to listen to others. And thereby one functionally cuts off the ability to learn anything from others. And this leads to neglect, to ignorance, to low intelligence, to low knowledge. So there's no need to pay further attention to anybody else if one has this negligence and connected with pride. This both tragic and somewhat comic self-imposed blindness is also reversible. But not before one's own futility is discovered, admitted by realistic self-surrender. Awareness sati established continuously on form, feeling, mentality and phenomena is therefore the first crucial and indispensable steps towards self-control, mastery, nobility and awakening. So when I try to measure on the internet how many are within the curable range, how many can benefit from the Dhamma, then I come to something like 3.6% repeatedly. consistently over many measurements in many different experiments. So this means that there's something like 96% that cannot get it. And when I look at this 96%, then why is it that they cannot get it? Is it because of lack of intelligence? They cannot understand it? No, actually not. In most cases, most predominantly, it's this self-imposed blindness caused by pride. I already know better because I have a higher education. I'm professor this and that, or I am lawyer this and that, or blah, blah, blah. I have written this and that book, blah, blah, blah. So there's no need to listen to this superstitious babble. And the system evaluation, there is a mind in behind there that could possibly understand it. The computer is okay. The CPU is okay. But because of the mental defilement of pride and arrogance, self-deception, and assuming a high state that is not the case, then these beings cannot see through their own pride, so to speak. So they are locked into their own mental defilement and cannot learn what should be learned. And so they are seen from that perspective incurable. They have to run out their line 100,000 rebirths more, 100,000 universal cycles more of aging, sickness, and death. Indescribable, even inimaginable pain and suffering they have to experience to break through this pride and arrogance. Significant. It's really rare to find one that cannot understand the Dhamma because of lack of intelligence. Even people with modest intelligence, they can understand the Dhamma if they get faith, satta. Then they can become very good Buddhists and make very rapid progress, and thereby have, at the moment of death, a much better prognosis than Professor Diladala that has rejected the Dhamma because he thought he knew better. However, if you ask this Professor Diladala, what do you know what will happen to you at the moment of death? Then usually they will come up short for a reasonable, absolute answer. They don't know. This they reject all their life until they come close to death. And this complacency caused by pride then makes their future destiny be whatever it may call be according to their prior actions, which is usually not very good because they don't think there is any afterlife. Well, no afterlife, no investment in the afterlife. No investment in the afterlife, usually downfall. So be it. Alertness, appamado, means awareness, presence of mindfulness, watchfulness, vigilance, attention, repeated observation, careful concern, and cautious consideration, thereby inevitably leading to thoroughness, meticulousness, enthusiasm, seriousness, diligence, precision, exactitude, prudence, and common sense and good judgment. No neglect leads to repeated scrutiny, examination, which leads to effects. Not running around with assumption of an I, that is this and that I, and don't need to listen to anything. So this naturally and logically pays off as all mistakes are eradicated, big as small. Mistakes go away, fade away, become more infrequent, become rare. Rare mistakes means very rare karmic bad results. Added up with good doing, then you have a good prognosis at the moment of death. Their painful, delayed after effects are therefore prevented. No mistakes, no painful echoes. It is a most precious mental ability developed and cultivated by awareness of the present posture, current action, body as form, present feeling, present mood or mentality, and present phenomena, just as mental states right here and now, unbroken and undistracted even for a single moment. It is the prime and indispensable key to Nibbana. As the Buddha said in his last word, transient are all constructions. Strive therefore enthusiastically. Appamandana Sampadetta, Tikkha Nikaya number 16. Mahanibbana Sutta, where the 3 months, last months of the Buddha is explained. Tikkha Nikaya is here. So alertness trained is like this. And now I'm sitting. Now this body is talking. Now this body is lying. Now this body is on the toilet. Now in this mind is jealousy. Now in this mind is goodness. Now in this mind is attention. Now outside there is blue color. There's cold. There's going. There's walking. There's sleeping and so on. So all activities regarding the form and the feelings that arise and cease, the mentalities, the moods and come and go, and all mental phenomena seen as mental states are evaluated continuously. Then, of course, there's no neglect whatsoever. Laziness and letargy, tinamita, means non-energetic, inert, inactive, idle, indolence, letargy, sluggishness, static immobility, sloth and torpor, inevitably leading to laxity, carelessness, sloppiness, neglect and imprecision. It is the third mental hindrance, nivarana, that grows when one is not paying attention to its presence, not knowing that laziness is in the mind. Especially after overeating or feeling sleepy at night. It is reduced by directing attention rationally and repeatedly to the aspects of 1. Initiative, 2. Launching, 3. Endurance. Initiative is, now I want to raise up from the sofa and get out going the dish, but body is not moving it. Launching is right when one starts to move the body, get it going, swings out the legs from the sofa and get up going. And endurance is when you're dishing and then not stopping the dishing or the task, whatever, halfway through. Or even not making it perfect, making it 98%, completing it, but it's only 62, 82, 98% complete, perfect, finished. This is just endurance that takes it all the way, the extra mile, until perfection, utterly perfection, regarding each task is complete. It is completely eliminated by meditation, turning on perception of artificial inner light, the Alokakasina. So this is basically one of the four meditation objects where you meditate on light, on turning on the intermental light, until your visual field is filled with a bright, uniform light, intense light. This means that you can turn on light inside mind, perception of light, without any light being present, even in a dark room, even with closed eyes. When you turn on light, then your mind becomes alert. What's going on? So opposite, if there's dark, like we turn on the light if we want to sleep, or we become sleepy at night when the sun goes down, then it's opposite effect. So this third mental hindrance of lethargy and laziness, tinamitta, goes away irreversibly by this meditation on light. So many were the words I give, will give the link below to the suttas that are free available on whatbuddhasaid.net under Anguttara Nikaya, the numerical sayings of the Buddha, which you see here again. Remember to click subscribe. This is, seriously speaking, your ticket to Nibbana, because it will keep reminding you of the Noble Eightfold Way. And this is more important than anything else. Thank you also to the donors and the supporters, especially those who have given food recently, and also those who have come with significant contributions to the building of the meditation hall. Thank you. May much merit be all yours. So be it. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Visitors from France are coming today, three of them. So the recording ends here, as usual, with may you have a nice, blessed, and alert, acutely, continuously alert day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.